Questions. The next item of business is a statement by Nicola Sturgeon on COVID-19 update. The First Minister will take questions at the end of her statement, and so there should be no interventions or interruptions. I call on Nicola Sturgeon, First Minister.
Thanks, Presiding Officer. I will give an update on the latest COVID situation and our best assessment of the current course of the pandemic. I will also, following on from last week's statement, set out a proposed change to the current COVID certification scheme and a rationale for all of the decisions reached this morning in relation to the scheme. First, though, today's statistics, 2,527 positive cases were reported yesterday, 11.6% of tests carried out. 743 people are currently in hospital with COVID, 7 fewer than yesterday, and 60 people are receiving intensive care, 1 more than yesterday. Sadly, a further 17 deaths have been reported over the past 24 hours, which takes the total number of deaths registered under this daily definition to 9,495. And once again, I send my condolences to everyone who has lost a loved one. More positively, the progress of the vaccination programme continues to be very good. 4,340,162 people have now had a first dose, and 3,940,314 have had both doses. In total, now 88% of all those aged over 18 are double vaccinated. In addition, 77% of 16 and 17-year-olds and 58% of 12 to 15-year-olds have had a first dose. And in line with updated JCVI advice, we are now preparing to offer second doses to 16 and 17-year-olds. As of now, on first, second, third and booster doses, I'm pleased to say that Scotland is still the most vaccinated part of the UK. And I want again to record my thanks to everyone involved in organising and delivering the vaccine programme. Presiding Officer, looking across Europe, we can see very clearly that the COVID situation is deteriorating again. As a result, COVID measures are being tightened or reintroduced in many countries, for example, Ireland, the Netherlands, Germany and Slovakia. At the most severe end of the spectrum, Austria is now back in full lockdown and also mandating compulsory vaccination. All of this is a stark reminder that the threat of the pandemic, unfortunately, is not yet behind us. COVID is continuing to force governments everywhere to take really difficult and invidious decisions. And of course, that is also true here in Scotland. While, thankfully, we are not at this stage seeing the rapid rise in cases that others are experiencing, the situation does remain precarious. Cases are on the rise to a greater or lesser extent in countries all around us, including here in the UK. And we are also entering a period when, understandably, people will be socialising and mixing more than normal. So even though our position now is relatively stable compared to some other countries, we must continue to take care and we must not allow ourselves to be lulled into any false sense of security. So let me now give some more detail on the recent trends we are seeing here. Last week, I noted that cases had increased gradually over the previous fortnight from just over 2,500 new cases a day to just over 3,000. Since then, the situation appears to have stabilised again. In the past 7 days, the average number of new cases being recorded each day has fallen from just over 3,000 to just under 3,000. It's been a fall of around 3%. However, there continues to be quite a marked variation between different age groups. In the over 60s, cases fell by 19%, and this, at least in part, is very likely to reflect the good progress of the booster programme. In the under 60s, though, there was only a very slight decline. A small fall in cases in those aged under 25 was almost balanced out by a very small increase in the other age bands under 60. So in younger age groups, cases have been broadly static over the past week. That said, a number of different factors will be at play over the next few weeks, and the combination of these makes it quite difficult to be certain about the course the pandemic will take over the festive period and into January. On the one hand, the booster programme will continue to gather pace and more people in younger age groups will receive their primary vaccinations. So we can expect the combined effects of vaccination to bear down on transmission and also, we hope, reduce the numbers who will become seriously unwell as a result of getting the virus. On the other hand, we can also expect more indoor mixing to take place as the weather gets colder and, of course, as we head towards the festive season. In addition, there is likely to be some waning of vaccine immunity, which, of course, is why booster jabs matter so much. And these latter factors will increase risks of transmission. And of course, while the cases are broadly stable just now, it is also the case that infection rates do remain too high and higher than we would want them to be. All of this is putting significant and sustained pressure on the NHS. In the past week, the number of people in hospital with COVID has fallen only slightly, from 779 to 743, and the number of people in intensive care has risen very slightly, from 57 to 60. So the number of patients in hospital with COVID is still high. The NHS is also dealing with the backlog of care created by earlier phases of the pandemic and, of course, the peak of the winter flu season, coupled with other winter pressures, possibly still lies ahead of us. Taking all of this into account and adding the fact that the R number is hovering at or slightly above one leads us to this conclusion. Our situation is definitely more positive than we might have expected it to be at this point, but it is still precarious. We need to get the R number back below one, and that means having in place a range of proportionate protections to keep the country as safe as possible while we continue to live as freely as possible. That is why the Cabinet decided this morning to retain for a further period all of the remaining legal protections, such as the requirement to wear face coverings, and subject to a change I will set out shortly, to keep in place the COVID certification scheme and also to intensify our public information campaign in the weeks ahead. I want to now set out and really emphasise today the range of protections that we judge to be essential, and I want to stress that word, essential, if we are to navigate this winter as safely as possible and, crucially, without the need to reintroduce more onerous restrictions. And, Presiding Officer, as we approach the festive season, I am appealing afresh to everyone across the country to comply with all of these protections with renewed care and commitment to keep ourselves safe, but also to show our solidarity to those around us. Firstly, vaccination. The duty of government is to deliver the vaccine programme, especially at this stage boosters, as rapidly as possible. Right now, that is my government's top priority. More than 1.4 million people, just over 30% of the total over 12 population, have so far had a booster or third dose. Within the most vulnerable groups, 87% of over 70s and 76% of those at highest clinical risk already have the protection of a booster or third dose. As I mentioned earlier, we are already seeing the positive impact of boosters in the case numbers. So the programme is going exceptionally well, but we are doing everything possible and will continue to do everything possible to speed it up further. Delivering the programme as quickly as possible is, of course, the government's responsibility, although, of course, we are reliant on and eternally grateful for the commitment of NHS workers in delivering it. The duty and responsibility, though, of all of us as citizens is to get vaccinated as soon as we are able. So if you haven't yet had a dose of vaccine that you are eligible for, please make arrangements to get it now. This is even more vital if you are planning to socialise at all over the festive period. If you are meeting up with loved ones and you're not as fully vaccinated as you could be, you are putting them at unnecessary risk. To be blunt, you could be putting their lives in danger. The most precious gift we can give anyone this Christmas is to be vaccinated and also tested, which I'll say more about shortly, before we meet, hug or spend any time with them. So if you haven't had a first or second dose yet, it's not too late, so please do so now. And please also get your booster as soon as you're able. A booster jab reduces the risk of symptomatic infection by more than 80%. So let me stress this, it's not just a small top-up. Getting your booster is every bit as important as getting the initial vaccinations. If you are aged over 50 or are in one of the higher risk groups and are over 24 weeks from your second jab, you need to book an appointment online via NHS Inform or via the helpline. The helpline number is 0800 030 8013. If you live in many parts of the Highland area or on one of the island areas which doesn't use online booking, you will be contacted separately by your health board. But for everyone else, please use NHS Inform or call the helpline. And please book the booster for as soon as you are eligible, which is 24 weeks after your second dose. Don't, for example, wait until after the Christmas holiday period is over. For those aged 40 to 49 who are next in line for boosters, and for 16 and 17-year-olds who will now be offered a second dose, information on booking appointments will be available very soon. Above all, today, I want to reinforce this vital message to every person eligible for vaccination, including pregnant women, whether for a first, second, third or booster jag, please book an appointment without delay and get your flu jag too if you are eligible for that. Getting vaccinated does remain the single most important thing any of us can do to protect ourselves, our loved ones and our communities. You could well be saving your own life and the lives of your loved ones. You will be helping the NHS and you will be maximising our chances of getting through this winter without the need for further restrictions. Presiding Officer, the vaccine programme is the bedrock of our fight against COVID, but other protections are vitally important too. The Scottish Government will be intensifying our public awareness and information campaigns over the winter period to make sure everyone knows what is being asked of us. So when you see those ads, please take a moment to listen and remind yourself of the protections that will help keep you and others safe. What are those other protections? Firstly, as well as vaccination, we are asking everyone to take regular lateral flow tests. We have been asking people to do this routinely twice a week. However, over the festive period, we are asking for extra effort, and so this next request is vitally important. On any occasion that you are socialising with others, whether that is going out for drinks or dinner, visiting someone at home, or even going shopping somewhere that might be crowded, please take an LFD test before you go. And if it is positive, do not go. Instead, get a PCR test and self-isolate while you wait for the result. This way, you are minimising the risk of inadvertently passing the virus on, even if you don't have symptoms. Also, please continue to wear face coverings on public transport, in shops and when moving around in hospitality settings. This remains a legal requirement, but it is also a vital protection. A study published just last week suggested that face coverings may reduce the risk of transmission by over 50%. And remember, good ventilation also reduces risks in indoor spaces, so please open windows if you have people round. And lastly, please do continue to work from home whenever possible. I know this isn't always easy for workers, nor is it convenient always for employers, but it does make a difference and it will help us navigate our way through this difficult winter period. The average number of contacts people are having in the workplace has doubled in recent weeks, and as we head deeper into winter, this will create an increased risk of transmission. The virus transmits, as we know, when people interact, and when people go to work, they interact in a number of ways, including through travel, during lunch breaks and after work. So support for home working, whenever possible, remains one of the most effective protections we have at our disposal just now. Signing officer, let me turn now to the COVID certification scheme, which Cabinet also discussed this morning, and set out the decisions we reached and the rationale for them. For context, it is worth bearing in mind that COVID certification is far from unique to Scotland. Similar schemes are in place in many other parts of the world. In fact, in recent weeks, certification schemes have been announced, reintroduced or extended in Denmark, Norway, Sweden, Northern Ireland and elsewhere. Many cover a wider range of premises than Scotland's does. However, we must reach decisions based on our own circumstances, and so I can confirm that the judgments we arrived at this morning are as follows. Firstly, for at least a further three-week period, we will retain vaccine certification for the venues and events currently covered by the scheme. That is late-night licensed premises with a designated area for dancing, unseated indoor events of 500 people or more, unseated outdoor events of 4,000 people or more, and any event with 10,000 people or more. Given the current state of the pandemic, it is our judgment that it would not be appropriate at this stage to remove this protection against transmission. Secondly, however, we have decided that from the 6th of December, it will be possible to access venues or events covered by the scheme by showing either proof of vaccination as now or a recent negative lateral flow test result. When we first launched the scheme, one of its primary objectives was to help drive up vaccination rates. This is still important, obviously, but actual and projected uptake rates mean we judge it possible now to include testing. Doing so will also ensure that the scheme remains proportionate going forward and also help our wider efforts to stem transmission through greater use of LFD tests more generally. And finally, as I indicated last week, Cabinet also considered the possible extension of the scheme to a much wider range of premises, including indoor theatres, cinemas and other hospitality venues. Let me stress, this was a very, very finely balanced decision. However, I can confirm that at this stage, we have decided not to extend the scope of the scheme. We have taken account of the fact that although our situation is precarious, cases are currently stable and indeed slightly declining, and we have considered the inevitable impact vaccine certification has on the operation of businesses and concluded that at this stage, extension would not be proportionate. We were also mindful of the need over the coming weeks, as I've already alluded to, of getting across the message that it is important to be vaccinated and tested ahead of socialising in any setting, including in homes and shopping centres, for example, not just in those that might be covered by a certification scheme. Presiding Officer, I said last week that we would take this decision with the utmost care, and that is what we have done. It is important to stress, however, that we must keep it, as we do all possible protections, under review. If our situation does deteriorate, it may yet be that extending COVID certification is a more proportionate alternative to the reintroduction of any more onerous restrictions on, for example, hospitality. And we'll continue to liaise closely with businesses about this and about what they must do in the coming weeks to minimise that risk. Presiding Officer, to begin to conclude, it is an understatement, I am sure, to say that all of us are sick and tired of this virus and the impact, although less than in previous months, it is nevertheless still having on our lives. I understand that. Indeed, I share that sentiment. But I'm also deeply grateful for all of the sacrifices everyone has made and continues to make. Thanks to those sacrifices, we are in a much stronger position now than I would have dared hope for just a few weeks ago. But I can emphasise strongly enough that our position is still precarious. The next few weeks do pose risks. Cases are rising in countries around us, and the festive period will bring more travel and more socialising. Of course, that is to be welcomed. We all desperately want a more normal Christmas than was possible last year. But we must, all of us, take sensible, proportionate measures to reduce the risk of a New Year hangover of surging cases, more pressure on the NHS and an inevitability of renewed restrictions. We can all play our part in avoiding this. So to everyone watching, my request in a nutshell is as follows, and please pass this on to your friends and family as well. This is what all of us, government, businesses and individual citizens, must do together as part of a social compact to keep each other as safe as possible and allow us all to live as freely as possible. So over these next crucial weeks, please wear your face coverings and follow all advice on hygiene and ventilation. Wash your hands and surfaces and keep windows open when you have people round. If you have eased up on this recently, as I know many of us will have, now is the time for all of us to tighten up again. Work from home if you can. If you think you could be working from home and you aren't, raise this with your employer. And to employers, please facilitate home working for a bit longer, as far as possible. To all of you, make sure you get any and all vaccine doses you are eligible for, including flu. For my part, I will continue to make sure that the government keeps rolling out the vaccination programme just as quickly as possible. And finally, on any occasion that you intend to socialise or mix with people from other households, whether that is in a pub, a restaurant, a house or a shopping centre, do an LFD test first. If it is positive, do not go. Self-isolate and get a PCR test instead. Government has made sure you can order these tests free through NHS Inform or get them at a local test site or pharmacy. If you don't have them already, now is the time to order some and keep your supply topped up over the next few weeks. All of these precautions really matter. They are part of our social compact. They will help protect us and all of those around us, and they will help us protect our NHS and all of those working so hard on its front line right now. So please, I ask everybody across the country to stick with these protections so that we can, I hope, have a much more normal Christmas, but do so without jeopardising our prospect of a much brighter new year as well. Thank you, Presiding Officer.
Thank you. The First Minister will now take questions on the issues raised in her statement. I intend to allow around 40 minutes for questions, after which we will move on to the next item of business. I'd be grateful if members who wish to ask a question were to press their request to speak buttons now. And I call Sandesh Gulhani.
Thank you. I'd like to begin by encouraging absolutely everyone who can do so to go out and get their COVID jag. The vaccine is our best protection against this virus as we enter the most difficult Christmas that Scotland's NHS has ever faced. We also welcome that the booster jag scheme has been expanded. And I'd like to thank all the fantastic frontline staff who helped to make this rollout a success. But even with numbers already vaccinated, we are hearing examples of people who are being forced to travel long distances to get the jag and people waiting long hours in the cold and rain. We have called for the reopening of mass vaccination centres to help speed up the rollout. The First Minister said that she would consider it, but will she today finally back that call? It's also welcome that the vaccine passport scheme is not being extended, but the uncertainty that this government has left hanging over businesses for the past 2 weeks has been unnecessary and unacceptable. The Scottish Government released their so-called evidence paper on Friday. Yet, in almost 70 pages, they were unable to offer clear proof of the scheme's effectiveness. It seems more and more likely that they're making it up as they go along. Businesses are scunnered, making them wait even longer to hear if they'll be facing extra costs and added burdens in the weeks before Christmas, which is a slap in their face. These businesses are not crying wolf, as an SNP MSP claims. They are raising legitimate concerns. The First Minister's statement says we will continue to liaise closely with businesses about this. But almost every business group, from the Scottish Chamber of Commerce to the Federation of Small Businesses to the Scottish Beer and Pub Association, have problems with the scheme. When is the First Minister actually going to listen to Scotland's businesses? And finally, the COVID app south of the border has the capability of registering a booster jag. The Scottish Government decided to develop their own app at an estimated cost as high as £4.5 million. So when exactly will Scotland's app display booster vaccination status?
First Minister.
The member says that we are, quote, making it up as we go along. We're not doing that. We are trying to take the best, most balanced, most proportionate judgments as we go. Not always getting it right. I've said all along, in a situation as complex and unprecedented as this, mistakes and errors of judgment will be made, and I'll always be candid about that. But if we're making it up as we go along, where it's taken us right now, and I'm not complacent, is to a position where we have the lowest infection rates in the UK and the highest vaccination rates in the UK. So I suspect that perhaps along the way, I'm being told from a sedentary position we wanted the highest. There's been a couple of periods where we've had the highest rates, but overall throughout this pandemic we have a lower infection rate than any other part of the UK. Everybody's grappling with a difficult situation. We're all taking difficult decisions, but we are taking these decisions in the interest of keeping the country as safe as possible. Let me briefly address the detailed points on the issue of the booster programme. Our booster programme is going exceptionally well. We are looking every day at how we accelerate the pace and progress of that further. We are using the available workforce as effectively as possible. And at the moment, our judgment is that the way the programme has been delivered is the correct way. Of course, we keep open-minded to other approaches. It's worth noting that mass vaccination clinics, although they have played an enormously important part in the programme in previous phases, also had the highest do not attend rates of all of the settings in which we did vaccination, I think, if memory serves me correctly. So we are progressing with the vaccination programme and will continue to take these judgments based on best considerations. It's the biggest, most complex vaccination programme ever conducted. That's true, I'm sure, for all countries. So there will be issues. There will be problems with it, and we will address those problems as far as we can, as quickly as we can when they arise, to make sure it's not just happening quickly, but it is as accessible and as convenient for people accessing it. And I want to thank everybody who's delivering it and everybody who has so far come forward for vaccination. In terms of COVID certification, I think it is absolutely right that we have the system in place right now that is in place. Equally, it is right now that we have vaccination rates at a certain level to move it to a situation where it is open to testing in as well as vaccination or as an alternative to vaccination. And we were right to consider extending it further, and we are right to keep that under review. In the face of this virus, the most foolish thing any government could do is rule things out before we have the evidence of that. It is always difficult to draw lines between cause and effect with a virus, but sometimes we have to use common sense about what does reduce transmission and what has been proven to be successful in reducing transmission. And lastly, Presiding Officer, on the issue of the COVID app, as I think I said last week, we are doing work right now to include boosters in the app. The reason, of course, why we developed our own app was that we were told by the Department of Health south of the border that to be part of the English app, which we explored initially perhaps doing, would take 12 months. Against this virus, we don't have 12 months. That's why we moved ahead to develop our own app, and I think that was the right thing to do.
Anna Sarwar.
Presumably, can I start by sending my condolences to all those that have lost a loved one? This virus, it has not gone away, and we must redouble our efforts to make sure we are coming through this pandemic together. From the start of this pandemic, the World Health Organization and experts have been clear that the most effective way to reduce transmission of the virus is testing. But when the government lost control of this pandemic, they were determined to be seen to be doing something rather than doing the right thing. So the government chose to pursue vaccine passports. Now, we know the vaccine works. It reduces deaths, it reduces hospitalisations, and it reduces incidence of long COVID. But the First Minister talks about common sense. That includes knowing that even if you've had the vaccine, you can still get the virus and you can still spread the virus. The most important way to reduce transmission is having a negative test. Now, with winter fast approaching, the First Minister says that we're in a precarious situation. We have spent months pursuing the incorrect priority. The government's own evidence shows that there is no real evidence of an increase in uptake of the virus. At the same time, we have seen that transmission has not fallen. In actual fact, transmission is up. We have wasted that time. So I welcome the change to include a negative test from now on. But frankly, we are in this position because the government couldn't accept it was wrong and move in the right place, despite the warnings from the World Health Organization, despite the warnings from medical professionals, despite the warnings from public health experts, some of the experts who the First Minister likes to selectively quote, and also despite the warnings of businesses. So now that we've accepted that we've done the wrong thing, let's focus on testing, but let's also look at where we are getting the biggest rises in transmission. The largest increase in cases are in the 0 to 18-year-olds, those that aren't included in the COVID vaccine scheme. And within that, the largest increase is from 5 to 11-year-olds. And that is because there is a spread of the virus in our schools. And that is directly linked to a lack of adequate levels of ventilation and virus protection. Asking schools to open the windows is in itself not a way of reducing transmission or adequate levels of ventilation, particularly as we head into the winter months. So what urgent support is the First Minister going to give those schools so we can have adequate levels of ventilation? And the final point, Presiding Officer, we know that the effectiveness of the vaccine reduces after 6 months of the second dose. There are over 800,000 people who are past the 6 months and who have not yet received their booster. What urgent action are we taking to make sure all of those people have adequate levels of protection as we head into the winter months?
First Minister.
Firstly, on vaccine certification, I think Anna Sarwar is just fundamentally wrong. And I think the error he makes is to suggest that you can just always pick one thing over another and not at different stages have a combination of things. So in the early stages of the vaccine certification scheme, One of the primary objectives was to drive up vaccination rates. So, he says it didn't work. Vaccination rates went up. We are now the most vaccinated part of the entire UK. So, self-evidently, we have increased vaccination rates. Had we at an earlier stage included testing as an alternative, we would have undermined the central primary objective of the scheme. So as we have got vaccination rates up and we move into a different phase, we include testing. Anna Sarwar oversimplifies things to the point where, in my view, it is dangerous if we had followed the advice that he would have been given us over the past number of weeks. In terms of his other points about testing, we are testing extensively and we will continue to do that through PCR tests and of course increasingly, I hope, through LFD testing. Transmission has been falling from the latter of the two peaks we experienced over the winter. That's a good thing. We now again have the lowest infection rates in the UK, although we are not complacent about that. We've got to use all of these tools and all of these levers in as smart and nuanced a way as possible to bear down overall on transmission. And right now, that combination of things that we are doing is effective. What we've got to ask ourselves is, will it continue to be effective as the other risks accumulate over the winter? And that's what we've got to be vigilant around. In terms of ventilation, if it was the case that we were simply saying to schools, open windows, and that was all, then Anna Sarwar might have a point. But of course, we have invested with local authorities in carbon dioxide monitors, in assessments of ventilation in schools, so that local authorities can take steps to improve ventilation. We're doing similarly with businesses. Last week, I confirmed the opening of a £25 million scheme to help businesses improve ventilation. So we're doing all of these things. We will continue to do all of these things. And I suspect the one thing that will stay consistent is that the opposition will continue to oppose all of these things that we're doing to stem transmission.
Alex Cole-Hamilton.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. Presiding Officer, for 2 months, the Scottish Human Rights Commission have been asking for the scientific evidence base behind the assertion of the Scottish Government, made again today, that vaccine passports prevent transmission. Well, we got that evidence paper on Friday, and Presiding Officer, it was mince. Now, we know, Presiding Officer, that lateral flow tests have been superior, always been superior, to vaccine certification because they allow venues to understand who is sick and who is well. It's gratifying that the government have finally realised that today, but only after weeks of uncertainty and panic caused to Scottish businesses. Now, we are in a situation where we have one scheme which has been proven not to work, combined with one which we know works well. We were told at the start that the fundamental reason behind vaccine passports was to drive up vaccine uptake because of their mandatory nature. Now that they are no longer mandatory, that reason falls away. So is it just embarrassment that is preventing this Scottish Government from accepting they were wrong to begin with, abolishing vaccine passports altogether and building a scheme around lateral flow testing at large-scale events?
First Minister.
I suspect Alec Cole-Hamilton lost the thread of his own logic, if he ever had it, in that question. I'm afraid I certainly lost the thread of it. You know, there might be some force to this, that the Scottish Government is just against all of the evidence, dreamt up a vaccine COVID certification scheme. There might be some force to that if it wasn't for the fact that countries, increasing numbers of countries across the UK, Northern Ireland and Wales, and across Europe and the world are doing likewise. Because yes, faced with a virus, it is very difficult to provide the hard evidence that intervention X leads to effect Y. Cause and effect is a very difficult thing to prove absolutely. But we know that vaccines reduce transmission. They don't eradicate transmission. Nothing completely eradicates it. Reduce transmission. And therefore, in a setting like a nightclub, if we ensure that everybody is vaccinated, then we reduce transmission. And by, over the last couple of months, insisting on it being vaccination, we have helped, amongst other things, to increase rates of vaccination. All of that is a good thing. Now that we're going into a winter period where we want to suppress transmission or keep it suppressed overall, and we're trying to encourage people, as I have been doing today, to use LFD tests more generally and more regularly, then it makes sense now to include testing in that. These decisions are not easy. These decisions are not straightforward. These decisions are never black and white. But if we'd been listening and basing our decisions on the oversimplified oppositionalist We say black, they say white approach of the opposition. This country would be in an even more difficult situation with this virus than we already are.
I call Fiona Hislop to be followed by Rachel Hamilton.
First Minister, it is essential in tackling the pandemic that people take up the vaccination, including the latest booster vaccination. But is she aware that there is still a persistent problem with the national vaccination appointment system and how it operates in Lothian? I first contacted health authorities on the 28th of October. Issues both in the portal booking system and the national vaccination helpline, as both have difficulty in identifying local appointments for my constituents. It fails to distinguish between EH postcodes and West Lothian constituents are directed to East and Mid Lothian, and that's up to 2 hours for public transport. Constituents are able to arrange new appointments easily through the local NHS Lothian COVID helpline, which has additional appointment slots to the national booking service, but it's not well publicised for vaccination booking purposes. I am aware of the overhaul of the portal on Friday, allowing constituents to self-select venues, but the delay between the policy announcements made by ministers rightly here in chamber and actual implementation of these vaccination policy changes needs better communications, so people willing, able and wanting vaccinations are not frustrated when they try and use the system. So can the First Minister instruct improvements to the system so those that are keen to get vaccinated can do so in a straightforward and efficient manner?
First Minister.
Fiona Hislop is right to identify the fact that it has been acknowledged that some individuals in Lothian have suffered inconvenience in having to travel beyond their local area for booster vaccination appointments. NHS Lothian is working to keep patients' appointments within the local area wherever that is possible, while also accelerating the number of boosters being administered. If unsuitable, appointments can be rescheduled through the NHS Inform website or through the National COVID Vaccination Helpline. Lothian residents who may face difficulty attending an appointment due to mobility issues can contact the NHS Lothian Flu and COVID Inquiries line for help with arranging support, and we're also currently exploring how and when it is best to begin offering second doses to 16 and 17 year olds, and of course we'll continue to prioritise vaccinations for those most vulnerable. There is always a tension, and this has been the case since day one of this vaccination programme, between speed of delivery and local accessibility. We will try to ensure and work with health boards to ensure that that balance is the right one, but overall, the quicker we get through this vaccination programme, the better protection everyone will have.
Rachel Hamilton to be followed by Siobhan Brown.
Presiding Officer, every week we come to this chamber with hope. Hope that the First Minister will instruct her government to do the right thing. In the past few weeks, I've raised flaws with the digital self-tracing form. I've raised issues about constituents obtaining vaccination certification. I flagged 7,000 outstanding incorrectly recorded vaccination records. Furthermore, my colleague, Sandesh Gahlani, has highlighted the English app recording the booster scheme and not the Scottish one. Presiding Officer, this is a really frustrating place to work in. In light of these unresolved issues, does the First Minister not think that the best Christmas gift that she could give to the NHS and to the people of Scotland is to sort out these issues here and now?
First Minister.
We know that many Conservatives find Parliament's frustrating places to work in, which is possibly why so many of them have second jobs outside of Parliament, of course. Or in the case, second and third jobs outside of this Parliament. But more seriously, look, on the issue of the incorporation of the booster vaccine, I've said last week, I've said this week, work is underway so that we can incorporate boosters into the Scottish COVID certification app. That is important. It is right that that happens. I'm not sure what the Conservatives are suggesting, that we should have waited 12 months in order to be part of an English app that does that, because if we had done that, we wouldn't have any COVID certification app right now. We are doing these things properly and effectively. We are also addressing issues that arise, as issues will arise in a scheme as large and complex as this. And members who have issues that constituents raise should write to myself, to the Health Secretary, to the relevant minister, and we will address these issues as we go along. Let me just, not in any way seeking to underplay the importance of rectifying any issues, let me just remind members across the chamber and indeed the public of this central fact again. As we stand here right now, Scotland is the most vaccinated part of the entire UK on first doses, on second doses, on third doses and on booster doses. So yes, I am sure there are issues that will arise that we need to address, but something I think in the Scottish vaccination programme is going extremely well, and perhaps the Conservatives might want to acknowledge it.
Siobhan Brown to be followed by Katie Clark.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and the First Minister for the update this afternoon. As the general public are still being encouraged to do two lateral flow tests a week, and in light of this afternoon's announcement from the First Minister that we're now encouraged to test before we go out, can I ask, when somebody tests positive for COVID and self-isolates for 10 days and therefore has a certain immunity, when should the individual resume doing the lateral flow test?
First Minister.
This answer, of course, is based on clinical advice, and the clinical advice is that people who have had a positive PCR test within 90 days needn't participate in twice weekly LFD testing. The clinical view is that in the 90-day window after a positive test, given the low rate of reinfection, it's significantly more likely that a positive LFD test would be a false positive result rather than someone being reinfected, and that may cause people then to isolate unnecessarily. If you recover from COVID and later develop new symptoms, you must book a new PCR test at NHS Inform and follow advice on self-isolation and household isolation. Again, you shouldn't use LFD if you have symptoms or are self-isolating, and anybody who wants to see further guidance on when to use an LFD test and when to use a PCR test can find this detail on the NHS Inform website.
Katie Clark to be followed by Bob Dorris.
The First Minister knows the vaccine starts waning around 10 weeks after the second dose. Given this and the number of people who are still waiting for their booster dose, does the First Minister accept that testing is a safer option?
First Minister.
I really, really, really want to strongly emphasise this point, that we shouldn't be telling people either or. Get vaccinated and test yourself regularly. It's really dangerous to start to pose this false choice. Yes, there are points at which we want to emphasise vaccination, which is what we've done to drive up rates in the early part of the certification scheme. But that didn't mean we were telling people not to test with LFD tests. Both are important. On the issue of waning immunity, because this is a serious point, my apologies, I think I omitted to answer this part of Anna Sarwar's question. It's not a cliff edge thing with waning immunity. Immunity does begin to wane as the distance between the second dose increases. 24 weeks is the interpretation of the GCVI 6 months advice that we are working to. Many people were already over that when we got the GCVI advice, so we've always been doing catch-up. Currently, we're getting through the catch-up quicker than other parts of the UK, but we are seeking to accelerate that all of the time. But at 24 weeks, it's not a case of immunity falling off the cliff edge, but it is important that people get their booster vaccination as close to the 24 weeks as possible, because as I said earlier on, the impact of that is significant. 80% increase in immunity, it's not marginal. So that point about immunity is a really important one, and I hope people... I'm grateful for the question, because it gives me a chance to underline the importance of getting the booster as soon as you're able to do.
Bob Dorris to be followed by Dean Lockhart.
Presiding Officer, a constituent of mine contacted me and commented that many disabled and vulnerable people in Scotland, like me, have been left unable to safely participate in society with no end in sight. They said they would feel safer with the extension of the vaccine certification scheme. So many of us today are relieved that it hasn't been extended further, but we have to acknowledge there are very, very worried, vulnerable people out there who are constituents of ours. Does the First Minister agree with me that the very least that we can all do is to follow the baseline measures in place to help reduce the spread and impact of COVID-19 and to offer at least some degree of reassurance to those who remain at particular risk?
First Minister.
This is a really important question, and I want to make very clear that that consideration is always very high up in the mind of the Cabinet when we're reaching these decisions. For those of us who are fit and healthy and relatively young, all of these protections that are still in place are an inconvenience, and we can't wait to get rid of them. But for people who are much more vulnerable, either by dint of their age or by other clinical conditions, these protections are just that. They are vital protections, without which people would be less able to enjoy all the freedoms that we all are enjoying right now. So often when we're considering protections, we are considering them from the perspective of the most vulnerable, because we want everybody to be able to participate in normal life. There are people who would prefer to see vaccine passports, COVID passports, being used in all settings. I understand that. We have to take proportionate and balanced decisions, which is what we're seeking to do. But I think for those of us fit, healthy and relatively young, it is worth bearing in mind sometimes that we have to bear a bit more inconvenience for the sake of the more vulnerable, and we should all make sure we comply with all of the protections we're being asked to comply with, because it's not only helping us, it's helping everybody else, and in particular those who are most at risk.
As members would expect, there's a great deal of interest in this statement, and I'd be grateful if we could pick up the pace of questions and responses. And I call Dean Lockhart to be followed by Stephanie Callaghan.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Accident and emergency waiting times at Forth Valley Royal Hospital have been the worst in Scotland for the past 12 weeks running. Staff at the hospitals are doing their best, but are facing enormous COVID-related pressures and need urgent assistance now. We have seen the British Army offering valuable assistance in other health boards. Given the situation in Forth Valley, will the First Minister and her government be taking any action to arrange additional support for NHS Forth Valley?
First Minister.
In terms of whether to request military assistance, and let me record my thanks again to the military for the assistance that they have been given to Scotland and indeed to health services in other parts of the UK, but any health board requesting that, it would initially be a decision of the health board. As far as I'm aware, there has not been such a request from Forth Valley. If that is forthcoming, obviously we'll consider that in the normal way, and should we consider it appropriate, submit that to the military for proper consideration. More generally, we are taking steps, additional funding, other ways of supporting health boards to redesign access to urgent care and to help ease the flow of patients through hospitals, to release the pressure on accident and emergency, and that will continue right throughout the winter period. All of our accident emergencies are working under significant pressure. What we can all do to help, though, is do all of the things we know will help to get COVID cases down, because above all, that is what's going to ease the pressure on our NHS.
Stephanie Callaghan to be followed by Gillian Mackay.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. While Scotland's vaccination programme is the most successful in the United Kingdom in terms of public uptake, 21% of Scots aged between 18 and 29 remain unvaccinated. Has the Scottish Government collated any information on the reasons why these young people have not yet come forward? And is the First Minister considering any new initiatives to encourage more young people to get vaccinated?
First Minister.
Again, a really good and helpful question. Yes, we consider on an ongoing basis how we can reach those parts of the population where uptake rates are not as high as they are overall. And one of those groups is, of course, young people. There are a variety of reasons why people will not yet be vaccinated. Some people will have chosen not to be vaccinated, and I would urge them to think again. There will be some people, of course, who are not vaccinated yet because they have recently had COVID. And as we know, if you have had COVID, there is a period of 4 weeks between having the virus and getting vaccinated. So some people, perhaps right now, particularly in the younger age groups, will be facing that. But we are continuing to take steps to say to people, if you're not vaccinated yet with a first, second or booster dose, if you're eligible, then it's not too late. Come forward and do that. And I would encourage MSPs across the chamber and their own constituencies to do everything possible to reiterate and emphasise that message.
Gillian Mackay to be followed by Rona Mackay.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I welcome the First Minister's emphasis on testing and the addition of a lateral flow test to the vaccination certification scheme. Could the First Minister outline what the Scottish Government are doing to widen the range of venues and settings that packs of LFD tests are available in to make it easier for more people to test themselves, and if we have sufficient supply of tests to cope with any resulting surge in demand?
First Minister.
In relation to the second part of the question, the short answer is yes. We keep supplies under very close monitoring. Obviously, one of the things that we are keen to do, working with the other governments across the UK, is keep supply of LFD tests accessible and free of charge into the new year. And there are discussions ongoing about that. I should say there's no immediate prospect of that changing, but we want to make sure that is the case for as long as necessary. We will, as part of our discussion with businesses about how we all work together to keep transmission rates under control. We'll look at whether there are settings we can more routinely make LFD tests available in. Of course, they are very accessible already through NHS Inform. If you order them one day, they tend to come the next day, or you can go to a local pharmacy or a local test site to pick up these tests. So the inability to get them should not be a problem, or the ability to get them should not be a problem and should not be a barrier to their use. But we will consider whether there are other settings where we can make larger numbers of tests available for people turning up at those settings to use.
Maurice Golden to be followed by Kenneth Gibson.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Mass gatherings for adults are allowed now, so will the First Minister let children have fun this Christmas and lift the ban on school nativity plays and Christmas shows?
First Minister.
I really would hope that, notwithstanding the political divides and debates between us, all perfectly normal in a democracy, that none of us would suggest that the motivation of the government is to stop children having fun. All of us want children to have fun, but we want children, like adults, to have fun safely. So the guidance around schools is being kept under review. We don't want any restrictions in schools or early year settings to be in place for as long, for any longer than necessary. We take advice from our education advisory subgroup so that we are basing these decisions on the best available information. And I hope children, like the rest of us, will have a much, much more normal Christmas than was the case last year. In fact, I hope children, more than any of the rest of us, have a more normal Christmas this year than they did last year.
Thank you. My apologies to Rona Mackay, who will be followed by Kenneth Gibson.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I think it might have been my fault I didn't have my button pressed. My question was about school pupils, quite like Maurice Golden, school pupils who will be taking part in Christmas events and as the holidays approach. And in light of the continued threat the virus poses to family members at home, can I ask the First Minister what guidance has been provided to schools to ensure that such events can take place safely?
First Minister.
Guidance, and if my memory is wrong here, I'll correct it in writing to Rona Mackay, but guidance is already available to local authorities in relation to seasonal events in terms of Christmas concerts, nativity plays. Within schools, the current guidance advises that there shouldn't be live audiences, but I know schools are having alternative means of making sure these are available and accessible to parents. But that guidance remains under review and will continue to be informed, of course, by the Educational Advisory Subgroup.
Kenneth Gibson to be followed by Colin Smith.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. On 12 November, NHS Ayrshire Nairn advised that Cumbria residents would receive their booster on Saturday, 27 November in Millport. There was no indication that only folk aged 70 and over would be included. However, it now transpires that islanders under 70, many with disabilities, are expected to travel by bus or car to catch a ferry, then traverse largs, possibly in the cold and dark, to obtain their jab. Does the First Minister agree that the Health Board should think again, not least because providing boosters in Millport will obviously increase uptake amongst islanders?
First Minister.
I think all health boards, including Ayrshire and Arran, should think very carefully about how they design the scheme so that it is as accessible as possible. As I said earlier on, there are always going to be tensions between that and getting the programme done as quickly as possible. I don't think it would be right for me to dictate in every local circumstance how that should be done, because local health boards know the local areas better. Of course, there are particular considerations in island communities, and I certainly believe NHS Ayrshire and Arran should consider the points that Kenny Gibson has made about Millport and make sure that they are giving islanders in particular the ability to be vaccinated without the additional inconvenience that going off island would entail. And the Health Secretary, I'm sure, would be happy to follow that up directly with Ayrshire and Arran.
Colin Smith to be followed by Christine Graham.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. We were too slow to introduce testing for key workers such as carers, too slow to introduce testing in our airports, and now we've been too slow to introduce testing as part of our COVID passports. It's not been a case of test, test, test. It has been slow, slow, slow. So with PCR tests half the number they were 2 months ago and LFD tests still not high enough, is the First Minister really saying that we're doing enough to make what she called for earlier on, that routine twice weekly test, the norm instead of the exception? Because it's simply not the policy of mass testing that we really need to deliver a real robust response to this pandemic.
First Minister.
Respect, I think Colin Smith is misunderstanding, or perhaps not misunderstanding, but misrepresenting, I'm sure inadvertently, the the point of testing in or out of a vaccine, a COVID certification scheme, because we haven't included testing up until now as one of the proofs that get you into a venue, doesn't mean we haven't been encouraging people to use LFD tests. We have. Every time I have stood here, I have repeatedly encouraged people to use LFD tests twice a week. We're now asking them to go beyond that and do LFD tests whenever they're going socialising in whatever settings. I've set out clearly, people are of course entitled to disagree with it, but the idea that we have not set out clearly a rationale for relying in the certification scheme up until now only on proof of vaccination, that is not the case. We've set that out clearly, but of course alongside that we have also been encouraging people to test. Uptake of LFD tests is good. We think it can be higher. We need it to be higher if we're asking people to test more regularly than has been the case. And testing overall has been very uptake of testing overall has been very strong, which is why we have been able to record as many positive cases that there have been as has been the case in recent weeks. So all of this we continue to work hard at. I don't stand here ever and say there's not more we can do on all of this, but I do occasionally think the opposition should perhaps give a bit of credit for the work that's been done, not by us, but around the country to deliver testing, to deliver vaccination and deliver some of the excellent progress that we are seeing.
Christine Graham, to be followed by Alexander Stewart.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. First Minister, I refer to the public information advertisements to go ahead in the coming weeks with the importance of mandatory face coverings in Scotland on public transport and now new recommendations on lateral flow tests. Can I ask if these will run across all the UK terrestrial channels, especially as more people will be crossing the border from England, like I hope one of my sons and his family, to visit relatives over the festive period, and many of whom may not be aware of the differences and the different requirements and statutory requirements in Scotland?
First Minister.
Adverts and campaigns as widely circulated and seen as possible. I can't stand here and say exactly what channels these adverts will be on, but we will make sure that's as extensive as possible. We can't always have these Scottish Government adverts shown south of the border, obviously, but we do try to make sure that people travelling into Scotland are absolutely clear on what the advice and guidance is in Scotland, and we'll continue to try to do that to the best of our ability.
Alexander Stewart, to be followed by John Mason.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. In the statement, First Minister, you comment and encourage pregnant women to get vaccinated. I also encourage them to do so. Therefore, what action is the Scottish Government taking to ensure that this message is being communicated across the country to protect pregnant women?
First Minister.
A range of different actions have been taken, and it's really important that we don't let up on that. So I know the Royal College of Midwives has been active in this space. The Royal College of Obstetricians and Gynaecologists has also been active. The government, through our clinical advisers, is trying to get this message across directly to pregnant women as often and as loudly as we can. And I would again appeal to everybody across the chamber to amplify that message in the local constituencies. It is vital that pregnant women come forward for the vaccination. It's giving them protection, it's giving their unborn child protection. There has been, I think, some concern about vaccination in that group, and it's really important that we continue to use all methods to allay those fears and encourage as high an uptake as possible.
John Mason, to be followed by Pam Duncan-Glancy.
Thank you. The vaccination programme clearly has been very successful, and last week the British Society for Immunology reminded us that somebody who has not been vaccinated is 32 times more at risk of dying if they catch COVID. However, some people are still hesitant, and especially perhaps in poorer areas and amongst ethnic minorities. Can the First Minister say if anything has been done to help them get vaccinated?
First Minister.
We address this on an ongoing basis and will continue. As long as there are groups of people unvaccinated or not fully vaccinated, we will not let up in trying to persuade people to come forward. In terms of minority ethnic communities, there's been outreach work done in particular communities through different faith and voluntary organisations. We have deliberately cited some vaccination centres in places where they are more accessible, Glasgow Central Mosque being one obvious example. So we will continue in every way possible, whether that's the location of vaccination, the messages and the location of messaging, to get this message across as widely as possible. Everybody out there, if you're not vaccinated yet, it's not too late, and make sure you take the opportunity to do so.
Pam Duncan-Clancy, to be followed by Evelyn Tweed.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To get to the truth and to make the change needed, the COVID-19 inquiry must support those hit hardest by the pandemic to participate in it. It must ensure duty bearers are held accountable, and it's essential that it's carried out in a way that does not discriminate, and that its work seeks to determine whether decisions and actions taken this year had a disproportionate impact on some groups of people. Can the First Minister confirm what the plans are to ensure the inquiry is based in human rights and do these things?
First Minister.
We've already given a commitment to this inquiry being one that is fully based on and informed by human rights and equality principles, and I repeat that commitment today. We are in the process of identifying and will shortly confirm the appointment of a chair of the inquiry and the terms of reference and the principles that will guide and drive that inquiry. We've given a commitment to having it established by the end of this calendar year. Once the inquiry is established, of course, its conduct will be entirely the responsibility of the chair, and it will be important that ministers do not interfere with that. But the work to establish it is well advanced, and we will set out details to Parliament shortly.
And Evelyn Tweed.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. With just over a month to go to Christmas, can the First Minister confirm whether families should expect to be able to enjoy a more normal Christmas this year?
First Minister.
I certainly hope so, and I, at this stage, am very optimistic about that, and that would be my expectation. You know, I'm conscious that we ended up last year with an unexpected development in the virus. I really hope that doesn't happen this year. So yes, I am very much hopeful that all of us will have a much more normal Christmas. But of course, to make that possible, we need to comply with all of the protections in place now and continue to do that through Christmas, so that we don't just have a better, happier, more normal Christmas, we also have a brighter New Year as well.
Thank you. That concludes First Minister's statement, COVID-19 update. There will be a brief pause before we move on to the next item of business.